Good evening, and welcome to the first event in this year's Humanities Lecture Series. I'm Victor Bailey, the director of the Hall Center for the Humanities, which sponsors the lecture series. Last night, the Hall Center was downtown at the Watkins Museum, hosting an event on the history of our own small town. Tonight, we're hosting a speaker, Professor Jared Diamond, whose work ranges across millennia and across continents. I'd like to think this illustrates the breadth of intellectual engagement the Hall Center brings to this campus and to this community. In addition to tonight's talk, Professor Diamond will join the Hall Center's Nature and Culture Seminar at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning in the Adams Alumni Center. This event is open to the public. Professor Diamond will also sign copies of his books immediately following the talk this evening. It didn't take me long to decide who should introduce tonight's speaker. Professor Don Worster is one of the most distinguished environmental historians in America. He returned to Kansas in 1989, the place where he grew up in the two decades after World War II. Already a celebrated historian of the dust storms that devastated the southern Great Plains in the 1930s, and author of Rivers of Empire, a reinterpretation of the American West, his homecoming as Hall Distinguished Chair in American History immediately raised his alma mater to the apex of historical scholarship about the environment. He has further consolidated his scholarly reputation with River Running West, The Life of John Wesley Powell, published in 2001 to great acclaim. In addition to all this, he's been a stalwart figure in advancing the mission of this university and of the Hall Center for the Humanities. Please welcome my colleague and dear friend, Professor Don Worster.
Good evening. Terrific audience here tonight. In the 1830s, a young British naturalist, Charles Darwin, traveled by ship around the world. He stopped for a while at the Galapagos Islands in the Pacific Ocean to study marine and bird life, famous Darwin's finches. And it was there in the Galapagos that Darwin gathered insights that eventually would lead to the Darwinian theory of evolution and the theory of the origin of species. Tonight's speaker, Dr. Jared Diamond, is, like Darwin, an evolutionary biologist, a naturalist, and a world traveler. He comes from Brookline, Massachusetts, not England. His islands of destiny have been in New Guinea and Indonesia, where he has gone on numerous bird expeditions, and where he has helped to create national parks and to conserve endangered wildlife. But Dr. Diamond's tropical islands have also given him a question to ponder, a question as big as the one that Darwin tried to answer. Darwin asked why there are so many species and where they come from. And Dr. Diamond has asked, why are some societies rich and powerful, while others are poor and weak? Now, many historians have tried to answer this question, usually by looking only at the modern period of history, and usually focusing on cultural factors, religion, the Protestant work ethic, and so forth, science, technology. In 1997, Dr. Diamond published an alternative explanation based on biology and geography in his book, Guns, Germs, and Steel. The book has been awarded numerous prizes, most notably the Pulitzer Prize in nonfiction. And in 1999, President Clinton bestowed on its author the coveted National Medal of Science. 5 years after its publication, Guns, Germs, and Steel is still selling briskly. I suppose the ultimate test of cultural significance in this country is whether your book is in the airport bookstores. And I saw it there, two bookstores, just this last weekend. One of my friends said that this is a remarkable book in an age when most of the books in bookstores and airport bookstores particularly are either about diets, cats, or how to be a success. Dr. Diamond is professor of physiology at the University of California, Los Angeles School of Medicine, where he has taught since the 1960s. It was his first job out of graduate school. He tells me he is now leaving that school to join the geography department at UCLA, where he will commence teaching environmental history to undergraduates. He is a member of the National Academy of Sciences and the author of several other books, including The Birds of Melanesia, Why Is Sex Fun?, The Third Chimpanzee, which is us, and hundreds, literally hundreds, of journal and magazine articles published in such magazines as Discover, Nature, and so forth. A student of birds, he is himself a rare bird. At once, one of the most foremost natural scientists of our time, and one of the foremost popular science writers. Tonight, he is here to explain that deep historical problem I mentioned a moment ago, the unequal fates of human societies. At the conclusion of his talk, we will have time for questions and answers. And if you look around the room right now, you will see microphones on either side in place. And we'll ask you, when you have a question to ask, to go to one of those microphones so that the whole audience can hear you. Don't be shy. You know, this is Lawrence. We're all neighbors, so go to the microphones and ask your questions freely. So now please join me in welcoming America's answer to Charles Darwin, Dr. Jared Diamond.
Be able to hear me okay in back? Can you hear me? Good. It's a great pleasure for me to be back in Kansas, with which I have long and interesting and happy associations. My first visit here was in the summer of 1956 when I was 18 years old, had never been west of the Mississippi, west of the Alleghenies, and drove an old Mercury station wagon across country. That station wagon was consuming gas at the rate of yielding 8 miles per gallon and one quart of oil per 50 miles. And finally, as we drove through Kansas, the station wagon was on the verge of expiring. We drove into a Kansas gas station, and a gentleman there put the wagon back in good shape, so we were able to return across country. My other memory of Kansas at that time is that we saw a road sign advertising the deepest well, or maybe the deepest hand-drilled well in the world, and I remember going in to see it. In those days, before lawsuits, this enormous black hole, 20 feet across, and something like 1,400 feet deep, had only a small, low handrail around it. I suffer severely from acrophobia, and I was absolutely terrified going to see that deep well. So those were my first associations of Kansas. There have been many others since then. Recently, for example, a few weeks ago, I learned that the river valleys of Kansas were probably the route by which corn and beans were transmitted by Native American societies from the U.S. Southwest, from the Anasazi, to the U.S. Southeast. And today, the driver who brought me from Kansas City Airport to Lawrence was explaining to me changes in agriculture from the time that he was growing up in Kansas and his mother was canning vegetables, and reminding me of growing up in Boston, my parents canning vegetables, and my observations of changing agriculture in Montana. So every time I come here, I learn new things, and it's very nice to be back again. An additional reason for my pleasure at being here this evening is that I get to discuss with you the most interesting, most important, most difficult question about human history, the question why history unfolded differently on different continents. Just to make this question, to bring it home and make it personal, as I look out at you this evening, it looks to me as if the great majority of you here are of old world origin, Eurasian or African origin, and I see rather few people who are evidently Native Americans. And yet, if we could have been at this same spot 500 years ago, everybody here would have been of Native American origin. Why did history turn out that way? Why wasn't it the case that, say, the Aztec emperor Montezuma sailed off to Europe in a fleet of ships with fierce Aztecs and conquered, exterminated, or drove out most original Europeans to the point where today those few surviving original Europeans would be confined to reservations up somewhere in the Alps or Pyrenees? Didn't happen that way. Why not? Although this simple question is the biggest question of history, it's one that has not been much addressed by historians, because it turns out that the answer has emerged in recent decades from fields of knowledge seemingly remote from human history, from fields like linguistics and genetics, archaeology, crop biochemistry, animal behavior. The subject, what I'll be talking about this evening, is well summarized in the subtitle of the British edition of my book, Guns, Germs, and Steel. That British subtitle was considered too flip by my American editor and so rejected it, so it's only on the British edition. And that British subtitle is A Short History of Everybody for the Last 13,000 Years. Now, you can do a calculation. The text of my book is 420 pages long. There are 5 inhabited continents. 13,000 years is 130 centuries, so we're talking about 650 continent centuries in 420 pages. That means that on the average, I can devote only 2/3 of a page to the history of one continent for a century, which meant that I had to omit certain details of history to get it all into 420 pages. And this evening, I'm going to summarize everything about everybody for you in 42 minutes, which means that I'll go at the rate of about 300 years a minute, or a continent every 8 minutes, and therefore tonight I'll have to omit a few more details, but I still hope to hit the high points of what happened and the main reasons why it happened. As background, because I'll be talking about seemingly abstract things like human societies and their development and evolution and change and competition, just to remind you that what we're really discussing is the fates of individual people like you and me, I'd like to begin as background, just scrolling through a dozen slides, portraits of people from all around the world. This is a cast of characters whose fates were determined by history, people like you and me. And I'll scroll through these slides of human diversity without commenting specifically on each slide. So could we now see these first dozen slides, just scrolling through them to illustrate human diversity? A convenient starting point is to appreciate that there are parts of the world with great human diversity, with lots of different peoples crammed into a small area, and other areas very homogeneous in their populations, where everybody looks the same and talks the same and genetically is very similar for thousands of miles. Among the diverse areas is the Indian subcontinent, where you get people speaking 1,000 different languages, varying greatly in physical appearance within a modest area. Even more diverse is my beloved island of New Guinea, where I do my field work, people speaking 1,000 different languages of great variations in physical appearance and genes crammed into an area the size of California. Nearly as diverse, Aboriginal Australia, 250 different tribes, lots of variation in physical appearance, and most diverse of all, sub-Saharan Africa. Contrasting with these areas of great human diversity are areas where everybody looks, talks, and genetically is the same for long distances. For example, tropical Southeast Asia. Everybody from the Malay Peninsula through the Philippines and Indonesia out to the most remote islands of Polynesia, they all speak Austronesian languages, they all look similar, they're similar in their genes. Or Europe is also homogeneous, although it's true some European populations are predominantly blonde and others predominantly dark-haired. Nevertheless, Europeans are very similar to each other genetically, and there are only 45 languages in modern Europe, of which 42 all belong to the Indo-European language family. Most homogeneous of all is the New World, all Native Americans from the Arctic to Tierra del Fuego look very similar to each other. They're similar genetically. And surprisingly, what can be called black sub-equatorial Africa is also rather homogeneous. That's to say, if you take Africa south of the equator, subtract the Khoisan people and the Pygmies, you're left with black farmers, all of whom speak Bantu languages, very similar genetically, linguistically, and in appearance. Why then these homogeneous areas contrasting with very heterogeneous areas? Is it just a matter of time? Is it that the places where humans arrived most recently just have not had enough time to evolve much human diversity? Whereas the places where people have been the longest have produced the most human diversity. The time factor could explain the homogeneity of Native Americans, because North and South America were the last continents colonized by people, perhaps a mere 13,000 years ago. There just hasn't been enough time for Native Americans to evolve much human diversity. But the time factor certainly will not explain those other paradoxes that I mentioned. For example, the famous fossils of Java man or Java woman tell us that there have been people on the island of Java and in tropical Southeast Asia for at least 2 million years. Why, after 2 million years, do all of those tropical Southeast Asians from the Malay Peninsula out to Easter Island, why do they all still speak Austronesian languages and look similar and have similar genes? Or, again, the famous fossils of Heidelberg man or woman tell us that there have been people in Europe for 700,000 years, probably nearly 2 million years. Why, after 2 million years, are all of Europeans so similar to each other in appearance, genes, and languages? Most puzzling is sub-equatorial Africa. Africa is the continent where humans evolve, where our ancestors diverge from the ancestors of our closest relatives, the great apes, 5 million years ago. Why, after 5 million years, are all of black sub-equatorial Africans so similar to each other? We can have the slides off now and the lights on. And by contrast, people have been in New Guinea and Australia for only 65,000 years. Why, after 65,000 years, is human diversity so much greater in New Guinea and Australia than after millions of years in tropical Southeast Asia, Europe, and sub-equatorial Africa? Evidently, either something happened recently to diversify the human populations of New Guinea and Australia, or else something happened recently to homogenize the populations of tropical Southeast Asia, Europe, and sub-equatorial Africa. And the latter explanation proves to be the correct one. The populations of tropical Southeast Asia, Europe, and sub-equatorial Africa were homogenized within the last 13,000 years, resetting the clock of evolution by what are called the agricultural expansions. So, what's the deal on the agricultural expansions? Until 13,500 years ago, everybody everywhere in the world was living as a hunter-gatherer, obtaining their food by hunting wild animals and gathering wild plants and small wild animals. Hunter-gatherer societies have for the most part been nomadic or semi-nomadic, meaning that they shift camp every few days up to every few weeks or months, and that's because the wild plants and animals on which they depend for food, again, either move or else fruiting and flowering is at different places in different seasons, so hunter-gatherers have to move camp to track their changing food supply. Hunter-gatherer societies have always lived at low population densities, typically one person per square mile, down to as little as one person per 100 square miles. Those low population densities of hunter-gatherers are for two reasons. One, that there is really little food out there for a human hunter-gatherer. Most of the wild plants and animals out there are just not edible to us humans and can't support a large population. And the other thing is that if you're going to shift camp every few days, the children can walk along with you only when they're big enough to keep up with the adults. And only when a kid is about 4 years old or more can the children walk fast enough to keep up with the adults. The younger children have to go on the back of the mother. But realistically, a hunter-gatherer woman can only carry one baby on her back at a time. She can't have two children less than the age of four. So hunter-gatherer women have to space out their births in various ways at intervals of 4 years or more. That long birth spacing and that low density of food for hunter-gatherers, that accounts for the low population density of hunter-gatherer societies. All hunter-gatherer societies have been characterized by relatively simple technology, stone or wooden tools instead of metal tools. And again, there are two reasons for that. If you're going to shift camp every few days or weeks, you can't afford to have heavy, non-portable technology to carry with you when you shift camp. You can't afford to have printing presses and iron forges and atomic bombs when you shift camp. And also, hunter-gatherers don't accumulate food surpluses that can be stored back at camp that could be used to feed people who don't acquire their own food but could devote all their time to figuring out how to smelt copper and brass and iron. So no hunter-gatherer society ever developed metal tools, and they remained with simple portable technology. Again, all hunter-gatherer societies were socially relatively egalitarian and politically non-centralized. The reason, again, is that they did not accumulate food surpluses that could be used to feed people who would not obtain their own food, but would spend all their time being kings and bureaucrats and tax collectors and priests and generals and UCLA professors and all those other parasites on society. So there we have a series of characteristics of hunter-gatherers. They were all, or nearly all, nomadic or semi-nomadic, low population densities, simple technology, socially relatively egalitarian, politically non-centralized and democratic. That characterized everybody throughout the world until agriculture began to emerge around 10,500 years ago, when all those things started to change. With the rise of agriculture, for the first time in human history, people became able to settle down in permanent villages next to their permanent orchards and gardens and pastures. With sedentary living, there was a population explosion of farmers. Population densities of farmers, instead of being one person per square mile or per 100 square miles, are typically 10, 100, or 1,000 people per square mile. And that's for two reasons, that in that garden or orchard or pasture, all the plants and animals are edible to us humans, so there's a much higher density of food to feed farmers than hunter-gatherers. And secondly, because farmers are living in permanent villages, they don't have the problem of shifting camp and carrying babies every couple of days or weeks. Farmer women do not have to space out their children at 4 year or more intervals, but in farming societies, the birth interval typically drops to 2 years or less. So that short birth interval plus that abundance of food for farmers produced the population explosion. Farmers, unlike hunter-gatherers, can accumulate food surpluses. They can harvest that wheat and store it in a silo in the village, and they can dry out the beef and the mutton. And all that stored food can be used to feed people who are not farmers themselves, but can devote all their time to figuring out how to smelt copper or bronze or iron, or how to devise writing systems and make pottery. So the origins of farming also saw an explosion of technology. In addition, the farmers, not having to shift camp, could perfectly well afford to have heavy non-portable technology like printing presses and atomic bombs. So there are the two reasons for the explosion of technology that began with the rise of agriculture. Those same food surpluses that could feed the craftspeople and technology specialists also became a temptation to some charismatic peasant farmer who got tired of going out there every day and hoeing the garden, and then got the bright idea of saying, "Hi folks, I'm going to be your charismatic leader. I've devised a law code, and I and my bureaucrats are going to keep peace among you. We're no longer going to have order maintained by killings and murders, but when there's a dispute, my judges will solve the disputes, and we're going to be a peaceful, happy society." Naturally, because this is a full-time job for me and my bureaucrats and judges, we don't have time to work in the garden. We're going to feed ourselves with the stored food that you peasants have brought home, but it's worth it for these wonderful benefits that we bring to society. And this stored food can also go to feed a standing army with which we can march next door and finally kill off all those no good people in the next valley who've been our traditional enemies, and wonder of wonders, will take over their land, and the land of our enemies can now be the land that you can give to your children. Isn't that wonderful? And just by the way, in case any of you peasants get the bright idea of revolting against me, the almighty king, that standing army is also available to put down your revolts. So the rise of farming then saw population explosion, technology explosion, social stratification, and political centralization. That then gives us a whole batch of reasons also why, whenever there was a conflict between farmers and hunter-gatherers, the farmers usually won out because they were far more numerous, they had better technology, including military technology, they had standing armies, kings to give them orders and make plans, and generals to lead them. So history has consisted of farmers defeating and driving hunter-gatherers out of all the lands on earth suitable for farming. Those defeats of hunter-gatherers by farmers are best documented within the last 500 years as European farmers spread around the world, exterminating or driving out the last remaining hunter-gatherers, those of Western North America and Siberia and Aboriginal Australia and the Sand People of Southern Africa. But these defeats of and or murders of hunter-gatherers by farmers began long before that. Given then these great advantages that farming conferred on the first farmers, you might naively expect that everywhere in the world, some hunter-gatherers would get the bright idea of becoming farmers, gain those advantages over their neighbors, and that farming would have risen all over the world. That wasn't true. Farming arose independently in only few areas, but even more puzzling, the places where farming arose include none of the breadbaskets of the modern world. For example, the most productive farmland and pasture in the United States is right here in the Great Plains and in my state of California. But farming and herding never rose independently in Kansas, the Great Plains, California, although this year in California are palpably the best places in the United States for the farming lifestyle. Instead, farming arose elsewhere and was imported along with foreign crops and livestock into California and the Great Plains. The most intensive producing farming in the world is in Europe. Europe never saw the independent origins of farming. The Indian subcontinent has 1 billion people who nourish themselves by farming. Java has intensive agriculture. The richest agriculture in South America is in the pampas of Argentina. The breadbasket of Southern Africa is the wheat belt of South Africa, and the wheat belt of Southwest Australia is the breadbasket of Australia. Yet all these most productive farmlands in the modern world never saw independent origins of farming. Farming arose elsewhere in a few places and was brought into the modern breadbaskets. The reason for this paradox is that for hunter-gatherers to settle down and become farmers, for agriculture to compete with the hunter-gatherer lifestyle, those first farmers needed a whole package of productive crops and animals to enable them to settle down and outcompete the surrounding hunter-gatherers. But only a tiny fraction of wild plants and animals lend themselves to domestication. and there were only very few places in the world, not more than 9, and maybe as few as 5 places with enough valuable, wild, domesticable plants and animals to enable hunter-gatherers to settle down and become farmers in what became the few original independent homelands of agriculture. This paradox that so few wild plants and animals can be domesticated is clearest for wild mammals. Around the world, there are 4,390 species of wild mammal, and every continent, even Australia, has hundreds of species of wild mammals. So you might wonder, why didn't hunter-gatherers anywhere just go out and domesticate some of the wild mammals near them and settle down and become herders? Why didn't Aboriginal Australians domesticate their wombats and kangaroos and wallabies and become wallaby herders? Well, of those 4,390 species of wild mammals, 2/3 are species of rats and bats, which don't lend themselves to hitching up to carts or milking, so we'll forget about them. But even if you just concentrate on the 148 species of big wild mammals, terrestrial mammals, that are herbivores or omnivores, the wild mammals that would be good candidates for domestication, again, every continent has at least a couple of those species of big wild mammals. Even Australia has 2 of them, the great red and the great grey kangaroo. So again, why didn't hunter-gatherers everywhere? Why didn't Aboriginal Australians just domesticate the big kangaroos and become herders? In fact, of those 148 species of big wild mammals, only 14 were ever domesticated to become the valuable big livestock of the modern world. And as luck would have it, of those 14 domesticated mammals, 13 were Eurasian species. And if I can remember them all, those 13 Eurasian big wild mammal species that were domesticated were the cow, sheep, goat, pig, horse, reindeer, donkey, Arabian camel, Bactrian camel, yak, water buffalo, bantang, and gaur, 13 Eurasian mammals, leaving only one big mammal species that was ever domesticated outside of Eurasia. It happened there was a big wild mammal of the New World. Can anyone think of that only big wild mammal domesticated outside of Eurasia in the New World? Llama. Some people here have been reading my book. That's right, the llama, the only big wild mammal domesticated outside Eurasia. What then prevented those other 134 big wild mammals from being domesticated? Why no domestic kangaroos, rhinoceroses, hippos, etc.? It turns out that for a wild mammal to be domesticated, it has to possess at least 6 separate characteristics. And lacking any one of those characteristics is enough to derail a mammal, wild mammal, as a candidate for domestication. For example, obviously, not even our innovative Kansas farmers would ever be able to rear in the barnyard an animal whose diet they cannot economically provide. And so anteaters, which are hunted and eaten enthusiastically in South America, they're good eating. There are no barnyard anteaters because we can't provide them with the tons of ants per day that they need for food. Other animals are domesticated, eliminated from consideration as domesticates because they grow too slowly. Not even your patient Kansas farmers would want to rear in the barnyard an animal that's slow growing and isn't ready to send to the slaughterhouse until it's 15 or 20 years old. You'd rather have a quick growing pig or sheep. And so gorillas, which otherwise would be fine meat production animals, easy to feed, because they'll eat 200 different species of plants. Gorillas don't reach full size, ready to slaughter until they're 15 or 20 years old, so no domestic gorillas. You also don't want to domesticate an animal, no matter how quick growing and easy to feed, which when it's big enough to send to the slaughterhouse, has a nasty disposition and is more likely to turn on you and slaughter you than let you slaughter it. And so what would otherwise have been the best meat production animal of North America, the grizzly bear, eats all sorts of garbage was so enthusiastically that it makes a pest of itself eating garbage in our national parks, and is fast growing, ready to send to the slaughterhouse in 3 years. But there's just one thing wrong with barnyard grizzly bears. Nasty disposition, same problem that derailed the domestication of rhinoceroses and hippopotamuses and lions and zebras. Another problem is that obviously we can't rear in the barnyard an animal with a finicky reproductive biology that just doesn't want to breed in captivity. There are some mammals that don't like to breed in captivity. And so, for example, the best hunting animal in the world, the cheetah, fastest land mammal, 70 miles per hour. The cheetah was the preferred hunting animal of the Indian Maharajas and Egyptian pharaohs, because at 70 miles per hour could run down any prey. And if you could have a 70 mile per hour hunting animal, you wouldn't waste time with some lousy greyhound or other dog that could crawl around on its belly at 32 miles per hour. The Maharajas and pharaohs hunted with cheetahs, but all of their hunting cheetahs were wild-caught cheetahs brought home and tamed. No cheetahs were ever bred in captivity. They were not domesticated because they are very finicky about how they reproduce, and it's only within the past few decades that zoos, with great difficulty, have gotten cheetahs to breed in captivity. Hence, no domestic hunting cheetahs. Another problem derailing some mammals from domestication is that it's easiest to herd animals that have what's called a follow-the-leader social structure. You've all, I'm sure, seen a line of cows, half-ton cows, or a line of sheep weighing 100 pounds plus, this line of big animals following some little 50-pound shepherd boy or shepherd girl obediently. And that's possible because sheep and cattle are herd animals. There are quite a few social animal species that are programmed with a dominance hierarchy so that they all follow the number one, the alpha male or alpha female, and behind the number one comes the number two, which everybody else follows, and behind the number two comes the number three. They are imprinted with these dominance hierarchies, and it's easy for humans to take over the dominance hierarchy. As far as the cows are concerned, that little shepherd boy, they're imprinted on the shepherd boy or shepherd girl just as they would be imprinted on the alpha cow. So those animals with dominance hierarchies are easy to herd, but many animals don't have dominance hierarchies, like most of Africa's antelope, or like the bighorn sheep of Western North America. The bighorn sheep is closely related to and very similar to the sheep of Eurasia that was domesticated, but there's one significant difference. The bighorn sheep does not have these dominance hierarchies. It does not have this follow-the-leader social structure, and so you cannot herd bighorn sheep, and they will not imprint on or follow a human, so no domesticated bighorn sheep. Still another problem derailing some animals from domestication is that there are animals, wild animals, which when you fence them in and they see a fence around them, they panic and they bash themselves to death against the fence, or else they may be able to leap over the fence. You can't domesticate such an animal. And for example, gazelles, which were the primary hunted meat animal of the Mideast and of North Africa, gazelles and most deer species except reindeer have never been domesticated, because when they see a fence, they panic, either kill themselves, or a gazelle can jump 40 feet and 15 feet into the air, so gazelles could jump over any fence that could be constructed until modern times, therefore no domestic gazelles or deer other than reindeer. One or another, then, of those six reasons derailed the domestication of the great majority of wild mammals, leaving only 14 big ones that could be domesticated, 13 of them being Eurasian species. Surprisingly, it's also the case that very few wild plant species could be domesticated. And that's even more surprising than for animals, because around the world, there are about 200,000 species of higher plants. Every continent has tens of thousands of higher wild plant species. So again, you might think that the hunter-gatherers everywhere could just go out and domesticate some of the wild plants around them and become farmers. Why didn't Aboriginal Australians just domesticate bottlebrush or eucalypt trees? Again, only a tiny fraction of wild plant species lend themselves to domestication. For example, take the large-seeded wild cereals that were ancestral to the wheats and barley and corn and rice, what are still the most valuable crops of the world, these cereals that provide more than half of calories consumed by people today. Around the world, there are 56 species of these large-seeded wild cereals, but they're very unequally distributed. 32 of them confined to the Mediterranean zone of the Eastern Mediterranean, the area of the so-called Fertile Crescent. and only one or two or no large seeded wild cereal at all in California or Chile or Australia or Southern Africa. So of course, hunter-gatherers of the Fertile Crescent got a big head start on becoming cereal farmers. As a result, then, of this unequal distribution of domesticable plants and animals around the world, the people, the hunter-gatherers in the area with the most candidates for domestication, became farmers earliest. And in particular, the first farming emerged around 8500 BC in the area called the Fertile Crescent of Southwest Asia, that crescent-shaped band of land running through modern Iran, Iraq, southeastern Turkey, to Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, Israel, Palestine. In that Fertile Crescent grew the wild ancestors of wheat, barley, peas, lentils, cow, sheep, goat, pigs, and nearby horses. So of course, given that they had the most valuable wild plants and animals of the world, hunter-gatherers of the Fertile Crescent settled down and became farmers before anyone else around 8500 BC. And very soon thereafter, or perhaps at the same time, hunter-gatherers of China, presented with the next most valuable group of wild plants and animals in the world, went out and domesticated around them wild rice and chickens and water buffalo and pigs and millets, and again became early farmers. Thereafter, hunter-gatherers domesticated wild plants in up to seven other areas, the highlands of New Guinea, here in the New World in the southeastern US, Mexico, and in the Andes, in three parts of Africa, tropical West Africa, Sahel Zone, and Ethiopia, but nowhere else. Only those nine areas became the independent homelands of agriculture, and agriculture never rose independently in Kansas or the Great Plains or California, Europe, those other places. Why? Although they're great for agriculture today, they did not, were not home to the wild plants and animals that lent themselves to domestication. They had to wait for those wild plants and animals to be domesticated in the homelands and brought in from the outside. That spread of crops and livestock around the world from the nine homelands came in either of two ways. The less frequent way was that in some cases, crops and livestock spread outside of the homelands and were acquired by hunter-gatherers outside the homelands who were thereby enabled to settle down and become herders or farmers themselves. The best attested example is in southern Africa, where some Khoisan people, so-called Hottentots, acquired cattle, sheep, and goats moving down the axis of Africa and settled down and became herders. But usually hunter-gatherers outside the homelands never had the chance or the time to become farmers or herders themselves, because instead the farmers and herders in the homelands spread outside of the homelands too quickly, taking advantage of their enormous superiority in numbers and military technology and standing armies and political leadership. Those replacements of hunter-gatherers by farmers outside the homelands have been witnessed in modern times as Europeans have replaced the world's other hunter-gatherers. And a result is that, again, as I look out at you this evening, a result of that spread from so few homelands is that I would guess that at least 95%, maybe 99% of you here this evening speak languages belonging to language families which 10,000 years ago were confined to two tiny parts of the globe. You either speak Indo-European, Afro-Asiatic, or Dravidian languages, which 10,000 years ago were probably confined to the Fertile Crescent, the first site of origin of agriculture, or you speak Sino-Tibetan, Austronesian, Austroasiatic, or Tai Kadai languages, which 10,000 years ago were confined to China. So the first farmers got a head start over everybody else and spread their crops, livestock, genes, and languages over the rest of the world. In addition, though, to these spreads of modern Europeans farmers at the expense of other hunter-gatherers, there were also ancient farming expansions. And they're easiest to recognize in cases where the ancient farmers expanding out of the homelands were very different in their genes and skeletons and languages from the hunter-gatherers outside the homelands whom they were replacing. So it's easy to figure out nowadays, without even written evidence, what happened. One example is that starting around 3000 BC, farmers from the coast of southern China, who had domesticated rice and millets and chickens and pigs, spread out from China to Taiwan, then south to the Philippines, west to the Malay Peninsula, east out to Indonesia, and then all the way out to Polynesia, replacing the original hunter-gatherers of this large realm, people related to modern Aboriginal Australians and New Guineans. So that's the reason why today, all those farmers from the Malay Peninsula out to Polynesia through Indonesia and Philippines, they all speak Austronesian languages and they look similar and they're similar in their genes because they all spread from an expansion that began only 5,000 years ago. And similarly, beginning around 2000 BC, farmers in West Africa living around the border of modern Nigeria and the Cameroons, who had domesticated tropical African millets and yams and rice and acquired cattle, sheep, and goats, spread east of the coast of Kenya, and then within a mere two centuries, spread all the way from the equator to southern Africa, replacing the original hunter-gatherers of all of sub-equatorial Africa, except in those few parts of sub-equatorial Africa unsuitable for Bantu agriculture, namely the Congo rainforest and the deserts and Mediterranean zones of southern Africa. And that's the reason why today all of those black farmers speaking Bantu languages are so similar to each other, because they all originated from an expansion that began only something like 4,000 years ago. Well, when I began to talk this evening and mentioned that I look out at you and I see all these old world faces, my guess is that at that point, some of you were starting to get embarrassed and concerned and ready to crawl under your seats in embarrassment or disgust out of fear that your lecture committee this evening had made the awful mistake of inviting in to speak to you some racist who was about to tell you why Europeans are genetically superior and deserve to conquer the world. And the fact is that when one talks about the European conquests, most people in explanation, consciously or unconsciously, fall back on racist explanations. Why? It's because this is the biggest question of history, cries out for an answer, and historians have not told us what the answer is. So we have to come up with an answer for ourselves. And we see that people have different faces and hair colors, so we assume that behind those different faces and hair colors lie different brains, despite the lack of any evidence for it. I'm always asking people, why do you think Europeans conquered other people? Why didn't Aboriginal Australians come and conquer Europeans? And within the last few months, I've asked that question of a cabinet minister, whose name I won't mention, and of a leader of American technology, not Bill Gates, whose name I won't mention, and lots of university professors. And again, the answer I get is, why did Europeans conquer these other people? I hate to say this. I know this isn't politically correct. I could get fired if I were heard to say this in public. But you asked me and nobody is listening. I'm sorry to say this, but let's face it. It's because Europeans have genetically a higher IQ than those other people. Just look at a picture of those Aboriginal Australians. You can see from their faces how primitive they are. And besides, they don't have the Judeo-Christian tradition or work ethic. Then people come out with those ridiculous explanations, which there's no evidence. Why? Because they're not told what the correct explanation is. In fact, the European conquest of the last 500 years transparently resulted from the state of the world in 1492 when Columbus sailed. In 1492, most of the Eurasian continent was occupied by empires with steel tools and riding and standing armies, while much or most of the rest of the world was occupied by people with stone and wooden tools, many of them hunter-gatherers of tribal societies, no standing armies. So of course the empires with the steel tools and standing armies smushed or exterminated the tribes with the stone tools and no standing armies. But how did empires and steel tools come to be so ununiformly distributed in 1492? It was the result of unequal rates of development of agriculture and guns, germs, and steel over the 10,000 years leading up to 1492. And those unequal rates of development had nothing to do with people themselves, but everything to do with effects of the environment, namely different distributions of domesticable animal species. For example, sometimes when I come out with this explanation to people who incline to racist explanations, I get a comeback. Well, Jared, that's all very nice, your historical speculations, but the only way I would ever believe those historical speculations was if you could prove it with a controlled experiment of building a time machine and going back and 13,000 years ago and picking up Aboriginal Australians, taking them to Europe, 13,000 years ago, taking Europeans, bringing them to Australia, and now showing me today that Aboriginal Australians were the ones to conquer the world. And obviously, I can't do that controlled experiment to convince the racist, but I can do the next best thing to do it. The next best thing, namely fall back on a natural experiment of history. Lots of racists incline to the genetic superiority of Northern Europeans with blonde hair and blue eyes. And 1,500 years ago, around AD 500, history performed a natural experiment with North Germanic peoples. They were distributed by history, and some of them emigrated from Scandinavia, where they evolved, to Holland, and some went on to England, and some went on to Greenland. And so if one believes in the intrinsic genetic superiority of these peoples, then they should all end up superior. And in fact, what happened after 1,100 years is that by AD 1600, those North Germanic people who had expanded out to Holland were producing some of the world's greatest art, the paintings of Rembrandt, and those who had expanded to England were producing some of the world's greatest literature, the plays of Shakespeare, and the same peoples who had expanded to Greenland came in conflict there with a Native American people using stone and wooden tools with no writing or steel tools, and if genetic superiority had been part of the answer, then those same North Germanic people should have wiped out the Inuit, the Eskimos, with no trouble. And instead, what happened when the dust settled is that by the year 1440, all of those North Germanic peoples in Greenland were dead, and the Inuit had taken over Greenland, showing that there was no intrinsic superiority to the Northern Europeans. It was a matter of the environment, and that in Greenland, where North Germanic peoples didn't bring or lost their guns, germs, and steel, and fought the Inuit on a basis of equality, they ended up losing. Well, at the beginning, I promised that I would summarize everything about everybody for you in 42 minutes, and that unfortunately means that there are quite a few important factors in world history that I did not have time to discuss, but that I did discuss in my book, Guns, Germs, and Steel. For example, this evening I've said little or nothing about the distribution of domesticable wild plants, to which I devote three chapters in my book. I haven't told you the precise way in which the development of writing and technology and government and organized religion depended on agriculture and herding. That takes a whole three chapters in my book. I haven't told you the fascinating reasons for the differences within Eurasia between the histories of China, India, the Near East, and Europe, a subject that I toss off in 9 pages towards the end in the epilogue. And I haven't told you anything about the effects of individuals, the great man theory of history, what about Alexander the Great, and I haven't told you about cultural differences unrelated to the environment, their effects on history, a subject which is easily summarized in 2 pages towards the end. But it's now time to summarize the overall meaning of this whirlwind tour through human history with its unequally distributed guns, germs, and steel. When about 15 years ago, after devoting most of my career as a UCLA professor to writing papers on gallbladder transport mechanisms for the world's other 5 experts on gallbladder transport mechanisms, I decided instead to devote increasing amounts of my time to trying to communicate to the public excitement in areas of science that concern all of us. At that point, I encountered the occupational hazard of the academic who tries to convey science to the public. And that occupational hazard is to encounter the journalist, the television announcer, or the radio announcer, or the newspaper reporter, who will say to me something like the following: Mr. Diamond, I know that you spent the last 5 years reading thousands of books and papers and distilling them all into these 420 pages of your book. But for heaven's sakes, Mr. Diamond, wake up. You have to realize that our television viewers and our radio listeners and our newspaper readers, they are busy people, and they don't have time for your 420-page book. So won't you please summarize everything about everybody, your conclusions for us in one sentence? And I was initially put off, but I eventually learned to do it, and my one sentence is something like the following. Ms. Reporter, the broadest pattern of history, namely the differences between human societies on different continents, seems to me to be attributable entirely to differences among continental environments and not to biological differences among people themselves. And after you've stunned the reporter with that one sentence, you can usually slip in a second sentence with multiple clauses, like a good sentence in a Thomas Mann novel, going something like this. In particular, Ms. Reporter, the availability of wild plant and animal species suitable for domestication and the ease with which those species could spread without encountering unsuitable climates contributed decisively to the varying rates of rise of agriculture and herding, which in turn contributed decisively to the varying rates of rise of human population numbers, population densities, and food surpluses, which in turn contributed decisively to the varying rates of rise of epidemic infectious diseases, writing, technology, and political organization. Now, as a biologist hired by UCLA to do experiments in the laboratory, to practice laboratory experimental science, I know perfectly well that most laboratory scientists may be inclined to dismiss historical interpretations like mine as unprovable speculation. Why? Because they're not founded on what laboratory scientists consider to be the hallmark of science, which is, of course, replicated laboratory experiments carried out in the lab by little men wearing white lab coats. The same objection can be raised against any of what are called the historical sciences, which include astronomy, evolutionary biology, geology, and paleontology. The objection can, of course, be raised against the whole field of history and most of the other social sciences. That's the reason why we are uncomfortable about considering history as a science. History is classified as a social science, which is considered not quite scientific. But let's remember the etymology of our English word science. Science is derived from a Latin word, scientia. And if you will go home this evening and check your Latin-English dictionary for the meaning of scientia, the Latin word scientia does not mean replicated laboratory experiment carried out in that lab by little men wearing white lab coats, but it instead in Latin means knowledge. The essence of science is to seek knowledge by whatever methodologies are available and appropriate. There are lots of fields that nobody hesitates to consider sciences, even though replicated laboratory experiments in those fields would be immoral, illegal, or impossible. For example, epidemiologists have learned a great deal about genetic resistance to smallpox, and they've not used experimental laboratory methods, such as taking everybody on this side of the room and injecting all of you with live smallpox virus, and taking all of you over here and injecting you with controlled saline solution. Instead, epidemiologists have used natural experiments and controlled observations on populations. Or again, astronomers who want to understand the development of galaxies did it not by neat lab experiments in which tonight they'll go out and turn off the lights on the Pleiades and Big Dipper and double the luminosity on Orion and the Milky Way and then reverse it all on Monday night, but instead the astronomers have worked out other methods of understanding the development of galaxies. Or the geologists who worked out the advance of the ice sheets across the Great Plains to Kansas and Illinois, et cetera, did it not by starting a new ice age tonight, overrunning Kansas with a new set of glaciers over the weekend, and then melting the glaciers Monday morning, but resorting to non-experimental methods, just as paleontologists came to understand the evolution of dinosaurs not by bringing back Tyrannosaurus on Saturday morning and re-exterminating him next week, but using other methods. In all these historical sciences, advances have been made not by laboratory methods, which would have been unavailable or immoral, illegal, but instead by other techniques, namely the natural experiment and the comparative method. And we've succeeded by these methods in gaining considerable insight into these historical fields without lab experiments. So we should surely be able to understand human history, because introspection and preserved writings give us far more insight into the ways of past humans than we'll ever have into the ways of past dinosaurs. For that reason, I'm optimistic that we can eventually arrive at convincing explanations for these broadest patterns of human history. So that's everything in 42 minutes. I would like later to have some time to chat with those of you individually who would like to, and to sign your books if you would like, but we have a little time now for questions, contrary opinions, expressions of outrage. So there are a couple of microphones back there. Any of you who would like to raise questions or comment, please come to either of the microphones, and for 10 minutes or so, I'll be glad to field questions, and then we'll go chat and I'll sign books. Anyone like to raise a question there or there? There. That's the subject of my next book. And in fact, it's not worth talking about what's going to happen 500 years from now. The only practical question is what's going to happen 50 years from now, because it'll all be settled by then. As you all know, there are lots of big things happening now at unsustainable rates. We are unsustainably increasing our utilization of the world's forests and fisheries and fresh water and topsoil and pouring out waste and increasing our demands on the environment, pouring out toxics at increasing rates that cannot be sustained for more than a few decades at most. So it's all going to get settled within 50 years. Either we get onto a sustainable course and we solve these problems in pleasant ways of our choice, or we fail to get on a sustainable course and these problems will solve themselves in unpleasant ways not of our choice, namely disease, warfare, and starvation. So if we get our act together within the next 50 years, then we'll have leisure to speculate about the 450 years after that. But I think the only interesting question now is the next 50 years, and all of you who are undergraduates or graduates, anyone here under 30 is going to see the outcome of that experiment, although I, at the age of 65, will not see the outcome. But that's the key question today. Another question. Yes.
Thank you so much. Can I take you to the Indian subcontinent for just a second? As a kid growing up there, learning history, we were told that the original Dravidians that were in the Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa civilization were taken over, and that they were agriculturally based, were taken over by these awful Aryans that came over the hills, and they were the actually, it was the other way around, where the hunter-gatherer enslaved peace-loving, agriculturally-based civilization that actually got rid of all.
Sure.
Could you comment on that? Then I have another question on genetics.
Sure. Very interesting situation in the Indian subcontinent. There was a replacement of so-called Harappan Indus Valley civilization, which was definitely a farming, herding situation, a civilization, eventually by so-called Aryans, Indo-Europeans, but this was not a replacement of farmers by hunter-gatherers. It was a replacement of one set of food producers by another set of food producers, because the Indo-European Aryans were not hunter-gatherers, they were herders. They were semi-nomadic herders who had military advantages. And there are many other examples of Central Asian food producers, herders, who conquered other food producers, such as the Mongols and Huns. And in addition, it used to be thought that the Harappan civilization was overthrown by the Aryans, but now we know that there was a gap of several centuries between the decline of Harappan civilization, for other reasons, probably environmental reasons, and then later the arrival of the Indo-Europeans. So that's a very interesting story in the Indian subcontinent. And another question?
I guess I'm the only inquisitive one among. I'm sure there's some other questions here, but I'm a physician, and here recently we've been discussing about how this whole way of looking at the genetic differences between people as far as drug availability is concerned, etc., etc., is really not the right way to go, because genetically, racially speaking, we are not that different. So a black population and a white population, as far as disease is concerned, etc., etc., and as far as drugs that we give them are concerned, are not that different. Would you agree with that or not agree with that, or do you have an opinion on that at all?
Yes and no. On the one hand, the pigeonholing of human populations into races, it's much more complicated than that. And most biologists would say, first of all, that half of all human diversity is not at the population level, but is at the individual level anyway, and the populations grade into each other. But the flip side of that, is it the case that physicians are getting away from genetic differences? No, they're going in the reverse direction, because it's clear that genetic differences between people are of great medical significance, that people react in different ways to different diseases and to different drugs. So just as an example, hypertension is, for genetic reasons, of different frequencies in different parts of the world and different types. And so as a physician, if someone walks into your office and you don't have time to do a diagnosis, you know that the hypertension of Africans is more likely to be salt-sensitive hypertension than the hypertension of Europeans, which is more likely to be subject to beta blocker drugs. Or again, we know that genetic resistance to malaria and the associated anemia, sickle cell gene, is at high frequency in malarial areas and not in Europe. So this whole area of genetic medicine is an exploding area. Question back there?
What was the hardest part of your book, like the hardest idea to write and explain?
Sure. What I found the most difficult part of the book was understanding why it was that most wild mammals were not domesticated. And in particular, I had to be able to answer, was it because there was some problem with the animals themselves, or was it that there was some problem with the people around there, that the animals could have been domesticated and the people could not? For example, sometimes today one hears that for some reason, Africans never wanted to domesticate any animal because there was so much wild game around them, and because there was something about Africans that doesn't like domestic animals. And I had to go to a lot of work to convince myself that that interpretation was wrong. The reason why I convinced myself that it was not wrong was six lines of evidence, namely that when Africans were confronted with domestic animals from outside of Africa, like cows, sheep, and goats, they adopted them enthusiastically. When European herders came into Africa, they too failed to domesticate zebras and hippos and all these other animals that Africans had failed to domesticate. There are specific reasons why we can now understand that zebras were not domesticated and horses were. So I found that chapter the most difficult chapter, but in some ways one of the most interesting. They're also interesting, one of the most interesting chapters of the book. Maybe one more question, then we'll go chat individually and answer book. Over here.
I have a question about food. Some advocates of different dietary plans now say that we should not eat things like sugar or grains, especially because we didn't evolve eating them. But, you know, we should go back and eat what hunter-gatherers ate. What do you think of that idea?
Again, I would say there's something to it, but it can be carried too far. I would not say that we should not eat grains or sugar. I would say that we should not have a diet based heavily on grains or on too much refined sugar, and that the most important things are not to eat too much, because overeating, whether it's overeating of protein, fat, or carbohydrates, and low exercise is associated with a disposition towards obesity, diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular disorders, and other things. And that in addition to regulating our calorie intake, we should limit our intake of fats, and we should limit our intake of simple sugars and have more complex carbohydrates, and we should all go out and exercise. So those are the simple rules to a healthy lifestyle. And that perhaps is a good practical note on which to end the official part of the conversation. Now I would like some chance to, I'll come around back where my books are out there to sign. Any of you who would like to chat individually or get your book signed, I'll be happy to do so.